Scale practice is one of the most popular areas of practice that we spend time on as we develop our intermediate and advanced playing skills on guitar. This is why it's so important to approach scale practice correctly and develop a series of habits involved with scale practice that will help us gain a very high level of skill so that over time we can start using scales to perform improvised solos. Now in this video I'm going to run through 7 things you need to avoid as you spend time developing your scales to higher and higher levels. All right, number one, you never want to get totally hung up on staring at a piece of paper for your scale practice or, you know, looking at fretboard diagrams for too long. You want to get away from that, memorize that scale as quickly as possible. You know, it's really the first important point. Out of all of them, you want to really think in terms of total memorization to your development of skills in the neck, and all those future skills are going to go along with that skill development. You know, these have, of course, just come together to the point of being able to improvise and compose your own music. And, you know, you have to allow yourself a lot of time and looking all the scales over, memorizing it. But once you feel like you're starting to get that skill memorized, get your eyes off the paper and start staring at your fingers on the guitar fingerboard and really, you know, allow yourself to get that scale out of your top of your head rather than constantly looking back at the music stand on whatever shapes that you have in front of you. You want to get to the point of being reliant on the memorization of that scale pattern that you have in your mind. And you want to have that committed to memory as soon as possible rather than constantly having to look at a sheet of paper. Well, the next idea that you want to avoid when you're practicing your scales is just jumping into your scales for the practice of them. You know, just jumping in and starting to play. You know, it puts you off balance and you lack the feel of going into the scale with some kind of a momentum building. So rather than just jumping into performing the scale, your execution of the notes and your accuracy, your sense of recall is going to be much higher if you feel your way into the scale prior to performing it. Now, the easiest way to do this in the early days of practice is just count in. You know, set yourself up. 1, 2, 3, 4. And it just feels so relaxed and comfortable. You feel like you're more on your game that way. Just a little bit of counting in. You could turn your metronome on, turn a drum machine on, give yourself that count in to lead you into the scale start. And I guarantee you, your overall performance will be much better than as if you just jumped into the scale without giving yourself any justification towards the feel of time. All right, something else you want to avoid when you're practicing is going through your scales in the exact same type of note duration all the time. You know, it's kind of one of those other areas of scale development where you want to be consistently changing, you know, continuously go through different note durations for your practice. So never perform your scales as only one thing. You know, just don't always just do them as quarter notes, or always do them as eighth notes, or always do them as 16th notes. You know, vary those rhythms around, even in one sitting. You know, go through all of those above ones that I just mentioned and then move on to triplets and then go on to doing other ideas with the scale, using them in more melodic ways, you know, be inventive and improvise lines, you know, so, you know, do something very different from the start sometimes too, your practice session. So instead of, you know, if you're always doing eighth notes when you start, maybe try and move to, you know, where it's triplets or something where it's like one and a two and a three and a four and a... And then, you know, of course, too, push yourself through coming up with melodic ideas. I'm just kind of making stuff up here, but you know, that's the idea, is to fool around with it melodically. Do embellishments, do slides, hammer-ons, pull-offs, all that kind of stuff. Make it musical and change it around every time that you're practicing it. All right, the next thing that you never want to do is become complacent with whatever speed that you're at with a scale. You know, if you feel that, yeah, I'm pretty good, you know, I got it pretty fast, I'm not bad at it. You know, don't take that kind of attitude. You know, make sure that you're always developing your speed and developing higher accuracy. You know, make sure, literally, that you're pushing yourself through different tempos all the time. Change the beats per minute quite often. Be sure to just keep motivating yourself to get that scale faster and more accurate, because, you know, becoming comfortable at one time frame and just spending way too long at one time frame, you know, one tempo, I should say, on the metronome is gonna sometimes do a lot more harm than it is good. You know, I've had far too many students over the years who've complained that they have no speed, but they've never pushed themselves to play the scales at faster and faster tempos in the metronome. Like, don't be complacent with, you know, oh, pretty good, you know, that's good enough. You know, you get it to some good speed, you know, get it ripping up on the neck a bit. Get it up some, you know, good tempos. And you know, if you get settled in at one speed, it's just going to be so detrimental because you'll be locked down in there for way too long until you decide, you know, something goes off in your mind and you decide, I'm going to just turn that metronome up and really crank things now. So, you know, avoid that. Really watch out for that. Do not get complacent at one speed. Push yourself all the time to faster and faster tempos. All right, another area that you really want to watch here that you don't do is just look at the scale like it's some kind of, you know, just a series of notes on the neck, just a geometrical pattern and nothing more than that. You want to look at the scale on the neck as a series of numbers. It's called scale degrees when you do it that way. And what that's good for is it helps you identify chord tones, build the extensions when you want to, you know, build those onto your chords. It helps you understand where notes fall, where intervals are going to be built from, the creation of different harmonies, how to transpose things down the road. It does so much for you to understand those degrees. All you have to do, it's very easy to do this. It's really two things I want you to think of in doing this. One is just play those scales and call out the numbers of the steps. So instead of just thinking A, B, C sharp, D, E, if you're doing an A major scale, call them out as numbers. And that's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 is the octave. And then when you go and convert that A scale there to, let's say, minor, you're going to want to call out those specific degrees that make it minor. So 1, 2, flat 3, 4, 5, flat 6, flat 7, up to the octave of 8. And, you know, if you have a Dorian mode, let's say you got 1, 2, flat 3, 4, 5, major 6, flat 7, up to the octave. So you understand now where I'm coming from. You want to understand these degrees. It's going to help you understand what's happening with different scales and modes, and then how to convert from scales that are, let's say, 7 tones into pentatonics. You'll get to know those degrees as well. You'll know it when someone says, hey, play me, a minor 9 chord. You'll understand where the 9 is coming from. You'll understand it when someone says, hey, play a major chord with an add 4. You'll understand the degrees and where they fall and where you can put your fingers to build all these concepts. If you want that second level of work on this, my other suggestion would be to spend some time drawing the degrees on a fretboard diagram paper. You know, just draw out the scale degrees on the neck so you really get to know them well. When you're playing on the fingerboard, call everything out. You know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You know, that's gonna be 1 again. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 2. You know, you can just keep going from there. And wherever you're at on the fingerboard, call those degrees out. Get used to knowing how they're all set up on the neck, and it's gonna be so much more beneficial down the road for all kinds of other work that you're going to do. All right, next thing I want to talk about is to not be picking the scale in the same manner all the time. You know, I've taught guitar for many, many years, and I can't tell you how many times people have come in and said one of either two things. All I do is I play guitar with my fingers, you know, and the next person, all I do is play guitar with a pick, can't do it the other way, never learned how to do it with my fingers, you know. So be sure to practice playing through the notes of the scale differently. And I mean differently in all kinds of ways, you know. Work with your picking hand with different variations on how the attacks are going to occur and all that. And then, of course, you know, try playing without a pick. Put your pick down and just try to play the scale down with your fingers, you know. Pick up the guitar pick, go straight alternate picking. Try doing all down picking. Try doing all up. You know, it's different when you're approaching your scale with these different picking patterns. Sometimes you may need a certain sound out of the guitar that'll only happen is if you do successive down picks or successive up picking. You know, also try maybe just hitting one note on a string and using the fretting hand to perform a series of hammer-ons. You know, that's called legato technique. In most cases, we call it that. You know, hit a note and then hammer on with the other fingers. And then go in reverse. You know, do the pull-off aspect. You know, just setting it up on all these different kinds of approaches, whether it's legato approach, finger picking, all downstrokes, all upstrokes, learn sweep picking, you know, going raking, you know, go across the guitar with the sweep action like that. Learn how to do all this stuff. You could do it in just small ways at first. You know, do a few strings down and then a few strings up. And after a while, your hand will get used to it. But, you know, you've got to try these different elements. Never get locked into just playing in only one way and then avoiding a whole bunch of other techniques could be a fantastic possibility with your guitar playing. And another one this brings to mind is hybrid picking, too, where you play a note with your pick and then, you know, maybe a note on the other string you play with perhaps your middle finger or your ring finger. a great sound as well. So try these ideas out because they're gonna make a big impact on your guitar technique. All right, now the last point I have for you is to never get hung up on just playing the same keys, you know, the same fretboard locations, the same places on the neck, day in, day out. You gotta go all over this fingerboard with your scales and understand how they work in all kinds of keys. So never get, you know, caught up or hung up in the habits of performing the scale in the exact same way, day in, day out. You know, you've absolutely got to change the way you practice these scales. And you need to do that as often as possible. Maybe create a routine on a piece of scrap paper, then that's what you're going to follow over the course of maybe 5 days or 6 days. Change keys, change fretboard location. You know, like if you're always playing in G major, you know, another day playing B flat major. You know, if you're changing the fretboard location, like, you know, that's another good point. So if you're always playing B flat major in the middle of the neck, you know, get used to how to do B flat major in another location of the neck. And, you know, just play high on the neck, play low on the neck. Notice what you need to do differently in order to feel comfortable all over the guitar or fingerboard. You know, play scales using some open strings. You know, get some opens in there when you're doing some work. You know, work at combining scales all over the guitar too. You know, you could have an E minor run over here, and then combine it into something up, you know, a little higher. And then switch positions again, whatever. You know, but work like that. Work very laterally. It's a different feel than, you know, when you first learn scales and everything's so when you're going vertical all the time. Go more horizontal with the scales and combine patterns laterally. It's gonna make a big difference. And this type of work really brings the scale to a whole new level for you. And, you know, your sense of control over the scale is gonna improve dramatically. The way that you write, the way that you improvise, all these forms of practice are going to get, you know, more and more and more accelerated for you as you get better at the scales traveling around the neck in different locations and in different keys. Makes a big impact to your playing. Well, if you avoid all these pitfalls that I've just broken down here for you, and you start moving in the direction that I was suggesting through each one of these points, you're gonna find that your scale practice is gonna go through the roof. You're gonna get to know your fingerboard like it's one big, massive, friendly place, no matter what key you're in or what you gotta do on the neck. Well, anyway, you know, if you find that you wanna learn more about what I'm doing on the internet as an internet guitar teacher, have a look at my website. It's called creativeguitarstudio.com. Just head over there. My step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced courses are gonna cover what you need to know, along with, you know, what you're gonna be able to do to move forward and become a much better guitar player. I've worked these courses with people since 1992. I've developed them and redeveloped them over 25 years, and altogether I feel that they're the best guitar programs that you're going to find on the internet. These courses are going to help you learn to identify what's required to get you up to the next level of guitar playing in a very organized way, very step-by-step methodical approach in these courses. And you know, that kind of approach to working just will make sense to you, and you'll be able to feel your progress happening as you move forward with the courses. So just head over to creativeguitarstudio.com, pick up your free general membership. There's no charge. You don't have to give a credit card number or anything. Just create a simple username and password. Get into the site. You'll be able to look at everything. When it gets to the point where you want more information, then you can just go and, you know, buy a membership, and it'll unlock all the locked up videos in the general area, and all of a sudden you're going to have access to all the information. If you take a premium program out, you're going to get a lot more, because you'll also get a whole bunch of handouts that coincide with the courses. So you get all the worksheets and a whole bunch of MP3s and so on. So it's a fantastic program. Go check it out, creativeguitarstudio.com. Until next time, take care, and I'll catch up with you again on the next video. Bye for now. I've got 25 years experience teaching guitar and have written a well-organized step-by-step guitar course. Head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com and sign up for a free membership today. Join the thousands of members worldwide who have already enrolled. There's no need to try learning the guitar on your own. Let me help you become the best guitar player that you can be.